Hey guys, and welcome to another episode of Digital Classroom, your favorite, well, at least I hope, show on internet. Well, it will not be your favorite show on internet. Of course, I'm a guy and you like whatever, you know what I mean, right? At least it's the show that you watch. Okay, so I think we have a solid stream on YouTube. We have a solid stream on Facebook, Annemiek.
I'm searching.
Anyway, we should have a solid stream. So let's start our digital classroom for today. And we have a very special one. I'm sure you're gonna love this one. Okay guys, and we're online with Digital Classroom. Let me see why Facebook isn't working. So let me see, start broadcast. Should work on Facebook, Annemiek. But it's on my, well, anyway, it's on YouTube. And YouTube, of course, is also one of the most important parts because that's where it's saved and where it's actually stored. That's the same thing. Hey, good morning and good afternoon or good evening or good night, wherever you are. Because we're doing it in English, so it's a worldwide thing. That's Facebook. Anyway, so we have everything online. Hey, today we have a question from, we got a lot of questions from you guys like, hey, I love to shoot stuff with light meters, but where do I use a light meter? I love to shoot stuff with, for example, weddings, but how do I do it with, for example, the bridal shot? Or I would like to have some differences between a normal shot and a more advanced shot. So all these questions we actually incorporated into this digital classroom. And well, for this digital classroom, we have a very special model. We have our stylist, amazing girl, great, great eyes, Annemiek, and of course, there's our model. No, I'm just kidding. We have our model, of course, Nadine today. And she's wearing a beautiful creation in white. Well, it's not a fashion show, but at least it's white. So, wedding dresses. How do you shoot them? What do you do with them? How do you make it interesting? Well, we're going to do two different setups. One is more like the pop and mom shop. Well, I don't have my day today. So when we actually start out with a very simple light setup, big softbox, 1.20 meters, light backdrop, white dress, and just get all the detail in and make sure that everything looks nice. At that point, it's very simple to, of course, say, hey, but this is too flat. But remember that for some people, this is the shot that they actually want. Not all people want an over-the-top, contrasty, Rembrandt, Caravaggio-looking shot. Some people just want a very simple shot. And remember that when you're shooting for a client, that client dictates what they want because they pay the bill. So today, we're going to do two setups. One, simple, the pop and mom shot. And one that's actually a little bit more extreme. And the cool thing is you can do them both in your own studio by just changing one light source. But I'm also going to add some extra light sources from the back. The challenge for today, making sure that everything looks fine. Well, that's a challenge every day, right? And the other challenge is making sure that with only one strobe, because often when you're on a location, you can't bring 10 or 20 strobes or smoke machines or whatever. So we're just going to make it very, very simple. One strobe as our main light. And then in the second shot, we are going to add a little bit more, like an extra strobe, maybe a little bit of smoke. I don't know, but we'll see. And at that point, we're just going to create something cool. Okay, first things first. You have to make sure that during Digital Classroom, you are aware that we are streaming live. So that means if I make a mistake, I can't correct it. So no, I'm sorry for that. The other thing is you can interact with us. We have two monitors set up. We have a monitor set up on YouTube and we have a monitor set up on Facebook. So that means that if you have any questions, you can leave them in the comments below later on and I will answer them. But during the live show, you can actually do it during the live chat. So that's pretty cool. You can interact. Now, the questions you ask, most of the time, I will try to incorporate them into the digital classroom or answer them directly or do whatever. Sometimes if I skip a question from you guys, it's not because I hate you. It's very simple because the question doesn't fit the program at that point, or I just missed the question. Hey, I'm only human and I have to watch a lot of screens and make sure that everything here works. Sometimes I feel a little bit like a juggler. And trust me, I can't juggle for beep. So a little bit of understanding for that way. Okay, so we have some people checking in. New York. Hey, Sharon, New York. You know that we're gonna come to New York, right, for a workshop very soon. So if you want more info, email me. We're going to have the page up very, very soon. It's after Photoshop World in Vegas. We're going to fly to New York and we're actually going to do a really cool workshop there. Only one day in an amazing studio. So that's going to be cool. Okay, if there are any questions in between, just let me know. I'm going to wait a few seconds on the chats. Annelieke, do we have any questions on Facebook?
Nope.
Okay, no questions on YouTube. The first thing we're going to do is actually we have to make sure that we can rely on our light meter. Now, the light meter is a very, very simple tool. A lot of people say, hey, light meters is for old-fashioned guys. Hey, I'm not an old-fashioned guy. Look, I have a modern smartwatch, so I'm really up to date. Anyway, light meters are not for old-fashioned guys. Light meters are actually for smart photographers. And I don't want to say that you're dumb if you don't use a light meter, but yeah. Anyway, what does the light meter do? It makes light metering literally a little bit faster, and it makes your whole workflow a little bit more accurate. If you want continuity in your shot, you need a light meter for the very simple reason it's an incident meter reading. It meters the light hitting that light meter, gives you a value, and at that point you know that you have the proper exposure in your camera. If you move outside or inside, it will give you the proper exposure, and that means that you don't have to figure around anything in your RAW converter. However, there's another part of the light meter that a lot of people don't talk about, and that's the reflective part. That's actually weird, because if you look at your camera also has a reflective light meter inside. That's actually how your old camera works. Imagine this, you're shooting outside in a snowstorm, everything is white, you take your shot, what happens? Everything will be a little bit grayish. Now go outside in the dark and you shoot something, what will happen? Everything will look a little bit grayish. So with your snow, it's actually a little bit underexposed. When you go outside at night, it's a little bit overexposed. So what's going on? That's what we call a reflective meter reading. Now the camera I'm looking at this point is a reflective meter camera for the very simple reason I don't have anything in front of my face. So the camera determines the correct exposure. How does it do it? Very simple. You ever heard about the bell diagram histogram or the mountain histogram? It means that in nature, when you add all the tones in a scene going from black to white together, you will have approximately 18% gray. 18% gray is middle gray. It's actually pretty dark gray, but hey, we call it middle gray. So that's a reflective meter. Now we also have the other meter, and that's incident. That's the meter we use for our models. The incident meter reader doesn't do anything about, taking an average. The only thing it does, meters the light that hits that light meter, and it will give you the value for that light, meaning everything behind the light meter, directly behind the light meter, is actually rendered correctly. We also can say that a normal light meter incident will give you the diffused value, or in other words, the value for everything that's behind the light meter. One of the most asked questions, for example, is where do I point the freaking light meter? Because I don't understand it, everything goes wrong. That's probably because you don't understand what a light meter does. Let me explain, very simple. An incident meter meters the light hitting that meter. In other words, if you want the correct exposure, you don't point towards the camera, you don't point towards the light source. You hold it in front of the area you want correctly lit. In 99.999% of the cases, that actually means, especially in the studio, that you aim towards your light source, because otherwise that light source wouldn't be there, because you're lighting the area that you want correctly lit, right? Okay, so what does a reflective meter reading does? It gives you the value for 18% gray. Now you might wonder, why the heck do we use 18% gray if it's not reliable? This is the most important thing about understanding light meters. The incident light meter gives you the correct value for the diffused value. In other words, if I want to shoot Nadine in a moment, photograph Nadine in a moment, we don't want to shoot her. If I want to photograph Nadine in a moment, especially with a white dress, could be interesting, Nadine. I love the color red, but hey, anyway, let's keep it civil. We're going to use Nadine more, of course. So what if we use that incident meter reading on Nadine? Well, it gives me the correct exposure. Let's say F8. Now, if I shoot on F8, Nadine will be properly rendered in the picture. It's the diffused value. Now, if I want to make sure that her dress doesn't blow out, how does that work? Well, in that case, I can actually pretty much use a reflective meter reading. I take a meter reading off her dress. I will actually get the value for 18% gray, and now I can start calculating. Now, in modern day cameras, you can pretty safely say that if you are 3 stops over that 18% gray, all detail in white will be gone or almost gone. If you are 4.5 stops below that 18% gray, you can pretty much say that every detail in the blacks is gone or almost gone. So your dynamic range And you can't really say dynamic range because the dynamic range of your camera is a little bit higher, but your dynamic range is approximately 3 stops over, 4.5 stops under. Now, if you start tinkering around with your highlight shader and your shadow slider, that's where you really get into that dynamic range of your camera, you can get back a lot more detail. But for the sake of the argument, let's say that normal, without tinkering with highlight controls or shadow detail, it's about 3 stops opening for pure white, 4.5 stops closing for pure black. Now, if you want a video on that, in the pause, I will actually give you a really cool link to our light meter video, which is absolutely awesome, I think. So, anyway, let me see if there are any questions online. Not yet. Okay. Now, the first thing we have to do is make sure that that light meter is reliable. Now, you paid 700 euros for a perfect Siconic 858. And of course, we highly recommend Siconic. But let's say you paid a lot of money for Siconic 858. Take it out of the box. Is it accurate? You might say yes, but in reality, no. The light meter is accurate, but it can pretty well be that your camera isn't accurate or you want different stuff. Now, over the years, I created a system where I think it's really, really handy to calibrate your light meter on. And I know a lot of you guys want to know how I do it. So that's why this digital classroom, we're actually going to start with very quickly calibrating the light meter. And in all honesty, it's incredibly simple. It doesn't take more than 5 minutes. So let's do that first. I'm going to switch over to our desktop and picture in picture. You can see my Capture One coming in, and I'm going to switch over to, let me see, picture in picture first. There we go. And then we're going to switch over the camera to camera one. Now, if you look closely, you can see actually that we have a big 1.20 meter softbox on our gray card, in this case an 80% gray card from Siconic, and we actually have one very big 1.20 meter softbox aimed directly at that gray card. Now, this is vital. You have to aim the light directly under the same angle. So don't do it like this, do it like this, like a 90 degree angle. Very, very important, because otherwise, if you do your color picker in a moment and you move it over the gray card, you can get different exposure settings. So make sure you aim it directly, or you remember where you hold the light meter, but it's better just to do it directly. Okay, so let's go to that setup. And we're just going to shoot my color checker, gray card, and let's see what happens. Now, of course, the first thing I have to do is meter that light. So I'm going to grab one of the remotes and my meter. And turn it on. That always helps enormously. Now, there's a difference, a distance between my light source and my gray card. Make sure that distance is rather large, for the very simple reason, if it's too tight, you can actually get a lot of trouble with the inverse square law, light falls off over the distance, so just keep a nice distance. Okay, let's hold the light meter in front. Let's go to incident meter reading. There we go. Just hold it in front of the card. And I now get a value of 8.01. Do that again. 8.01, 8.02, 8.01, so it's approximately 8.01. So go down one click, 8.0, 8.0, 8.0. Now, the reason I do this a few times is very, very simple. You have to make sure that you have a constant quality of light, because we are calibrating our light meter on 1/10 of an f-stop. If you have a strobe system that will go like f8, 8.3, 5.68, 8.3, 8.2, stop calibrating that light meter. Won't work, because there's too much variation in your strobes. First, change your flash tube, or maybe change the brand. We can highly recommend Hensel. Maybe a little bit too commercial. Hey, cut it out. No, we can't cut it out. We highly recommend Hensel. So anyway, so I'm going to grab my camera. I'm going to shoot this on f8, because that's what the light meter tells me. And let me see. So, just zoom in. Under the same angle, not that important, but hey. Okay, that's shot one. I'm gonna grab the meter. I'm gonna go to my computer. Now, I shot this on f8, so that means that in theory, and also in practice, of course, we should be able to get a proper reading of 18% gray. Now, first off, what is 18% gray? 18% gray is middle gray. Now, if we look at the digital system, we have a range from 0 to 254. 254 being totally blown out white, 0 being totally blown out blacks. Blown out, blocked blacks, you're right. So, what is the middle? The middle is 1-4, 1-8, and anything, let's say, between 1-5 and 130, it's all okay. So let's see how we are. So you take your color picker, you can do this also in Lightroom, by the way, it works exactly the same. You go here, and you click. Okay, I now have a setting of 133, 137, 134, an average of 136. That's not exactly, of course, 125, 126 where I want to go. Okay, so I turn on my light meter. Now this varies a little bit. If you have the older Cyconics, you have to press the two ISO buttons and you can change the exposure. In this one, let me see if I can do this correctly. Probably not. You go to your gear and you go to set exposure compensation. And now I can actually do this in, let's say, minus 0.1. Okay, 1/10 of an f-stop off. As you can see now, my light meter doesn't say f8 anymore, but f8.01. That means 1/10 of an f-stop extra. Okay, let's go back to our light setup. Please don't touch the cameras. Let's go back to the light setup and let's do it again. And then we're already done, because this is all you have to do. Where's the remote? Over here. Okay, we've done exactly the same as before, so we're going to meter. 8.01. Okay, cool. So we're going to go down. One click. 8.0. Okay, so we're on f8.0. It's pretty safe to say. Grab the camera. Shoot exactly the same image, so don't change anything on the camera. There we go. And now we should be pretty much in the ballpark with -1/10 of an f-stop. Now, in all honesty, 1/10 of an f-stop, that's not a lot. There we go. And an average of 1-8. That's okay. That's more than enough. If I do 1-8 times 2, I'm in that ballpark around a little bit over 255. That's okay. You see, if I move around a little bit, you can see it changing. And 1/10 of an f-stop, I'd rather be a little bit high than a little bit low. So that's okay. But that's not all. We have to do one more thing, and that's reflective meter reading. So I'm going to go back. And we're going to do reflective. Now, reflective is a little bit different. In all essence, I don't even have to take a shot. The only thing I have to do is I have to make sure that with reflective, I'm also on F8. So I'm going to change my light meter to reflective metering. And I have to look through the viewfinder of the light meter. And it is an 18% gray card. So it should say F8. And it doesn't. It says F8.5. So go in here. Go to exposure compensation. Type in -0.5. And press OK. Sorry. It's overexposing. So set exposure compensation on +0.5. Okay. And there we go. Okay, let's do that again. I did something wrong, guys. Excuse me. One moment. Let's go to 0. Okay. Let's change this to +0.5. Okay, now I'm on F8. An incident. Zero. Okay, cool. Okay, done. So minus. By accident, I did it in incident. Cool. Okay, so now we have -0.05 on our reflective and -1. on our incident. So that means that in essence, when I now shoot my model, I know that both my reflective and my incident are actually correct. Let me store this very quickly. So let's do that. -0.5. Okay, that's done. And now we go to reflective, +5, perfect. Okay.
There's a question on Facebook Live.
Okay. There's a question. Please ask.
There's also an option to get your dynamic range added to the light meter, right?
Correct.
Using the exposure profile target.
Yep. We have the exposure profile target over there. So yes, you can also do dynamic range. The reason I'm not doing it is because in my work, and remember this is personal, in my work I don't use the dynamic range of the meter that much. For the very simple reason, I don't do any still lives. I mostly do fashion, and in all honesty, I don't have to meter the whole scene. Now, the cool thing about dynamic range is that you can do different settings, and there's actually a button underneath there. I don't know if you can see it. It's called EV, evaluate, or in other words, it can do an average. And at that point, you can literally just do that. Okay, let me see. Let's go back to incident. Okay, we have a little bit of a bug in our light meter. Because the moment I go back to incident, it will actually give me the wrong value. So let me just correct that very quickly. -0.5. That's something I have to be aware of. Okay. Any more questions, Annemiek?
Not on Facebook and also not on YouTube.
Not on YouTube? Okay, let's bring in the model. And let's just very simply try to do some cool shots. And let me see if everything works now. I stored it now differently. Yeah, now everything works. So now when you look at the meter, by the way, you can see that on top when I do my incident, you see -0.1. So 1/10 of an f-stop. When I switch over to reflective, you can see on the top +0.5. So that actually means that calibrating your light meter is now done and we're ready. Okay. So let's take out that gray card behind our model because that looks annoying as heck. And let's just switch over to Nadine. And that's camera one. Okay. Cool. Yes, you have a question?
Yeah. Will you be going to the photography show again this
year? Yep. Will you be going to the photography show again this year because Jeremy doesn't have a microphone? Yes, we will be at the photography show in England. And I will be there 2 days, on Saturday and Sunday, I believe, in a week,
yes.
Doing a shoot on the live shoot theater. So we're not going to be on any booths, but we are there for the photography show organization. So that's a very big honor. I love it. Okay, Nadine is here with her wedding dress. Now, the first thing, of course, that we want to do is make sure that we get a nice and proper mom and pop shop. Very, very shot. Why shop? Anyway, okay, so incident meter reading, for the very simple reason, we want to make sure that we have incident. And I'm going to hold it in front of the face of the model. Now, the light is now pretty much straight on her. I don't like it. I also want a little bit of the shadow area. And there's another thing. When I shoot it straight on the model, there's always something called the angle of incidence is angle of reflection. Now, that's for glasses. In other words, if you shoot from this angle, glasses, reflection will be that way. So make sure that you shoot from here. If you shoot from that angle, you will see the strip light or your modifier or whatever you use. Same thing goes for shadows. If I follow this line, I can actually see that behind my model now there will be a shadow on the back. I can solve this by going to a really low angle and cutting that shadow out. But it won't look very nice. There are two solutions for this. One, place your model against the backdrop, meaning that she's against the backdrop, meaning that she makes connection with the backdrop, and then that shadow becomes cool. And if it isn't cool, just tell your client that you love it and it's your creative freedom. Whatever, always if something goes wrong, it's your creative freedom. But what you can always do is just move this a little bit to the side and just create some shadow. And at that point, the model only has to look towards that light source, and it is a beautiful light. Okay, let me see. F8.08. So let's go down. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Should be F8 now. There we go. And of course you can meter like this. Okay, that's half a stop less. That's full stop less. Okay, there we go, 4.07. But it's way nicer and it looks more interesting to just very simple take your camera, sit down where you want to take the shot, and just very simple use a reflective meter reading. Annemiek, am I on that camera now? I know I'm going fast, keep following me. Okay, now the only thing I have to do is aim at the light area of her dress. And I'm on 11.5. Now going from F8, one step up, F11, half a step up is actually 11.5. So 1.5 steps up. Now when I look at the dress, it isn't white. It's a little bit creamy white. So that means that I'm pretty much in the ballpark by using my reflective meter. Now if she would be wearing a totally white dress, there's something else. And now watch this, because I'm going to show you a really cool trick. First, let's shoot it on F8. Let's make it normal. Okay, there we go. Awesome. With a little bit of shadow behind the model, I don't really care for that. It's okay. If I really want to take it out, I can move the backdrop, or I can simply just lower my angle just a little bit, like going here. Really nice. That's cool. Okay. Nice. Cool. Okay, now let's say that we want to spice this shot up just a little bit, because this is accurate. It's nice. But we don't want it nice. We want it really, really cool. So we want to overexpose a little bit. Now, how much do you want to overexpose this? You want that really nice, creamy, crystally, almost porcelain look. Well, thanks to our reflective meter reading, I now know how far I can push this shot to go all the way up to pure white on her dress. Remember the 3.5 stops, the 3 stops over will be pure white? That means that I can open up my camera, not to 5.6, but actually to 5.0, and have a really overexposed look without blowing out her dress. Remember, I was already at 11.5. By opening up, I'm now almost at 3 stops over. So I'm getting a nice quality of light, but I'm not blowing out any highlights. And this actually makes this little beige-like dress pure white and gives Nadine a beautiful, beautiful look. Now, the reason I'm doing this is very, very simple. I'm lazy with retouching, if I need to. Now, if I do a fashion shot and I'm getting a lot of money for my shots, which is actually hardly ever, that's a nice shot, beautiful. Cool. At that point, I can spend a lot of time in retouching. But if you do a wedding and you want to do a nice shoot of the bride, you often don't get a lot of money for that. So when you overexpose her skin just a little bit, it smoothens already out that skin tone and makes it a little bit more interesting. Now, of course, we also want to make sure that we have proper color. And that's where we actually use a color checker. So can I get a color checker from you? Now, do remember, officially my exposure is F8. So I have to go back to F8. Okay. And the model has to hold this in front of her face. Very, very nice. And there we go. And just make a funny face. And 1, 2, 3. There we go. Awesome. Okay, Nadine, you can go for the next setup. And let us just see what we can do with this. Are there any questions in between, Annemiek?
No. A lot of friends are watching.
Okay.
And somebody says ETTR is always possible.
ETTR?
I don't know what ETTR.
ETTL.
Oh, maybe it's an error.
ETTR?
Yeah, I think it's a spelling error. Be honest.
Frans, can you please explain to me what you mean with ETTR? Because maybe I'm doing something wrong. Jeff says low quality video. Refresh, because we are outputting on 1080p, so it should be pretty good. Let me very quickly see what ETTR is. Maybe I'm missing something. Oh, exposed to the right. Yeah. that's what I actually did now with that last set. Okay, there we go. Okay, now the thing that I did, this is why I shot the color checker, is I have to have a proper color balance. So I'm just clicking on one of these. There we go. And I'm just going to copy this to all the other shots. No. Come on. Okay. Copy adjustments. And that's white balance. Okay. Now all the shots have proper white balance. Now that's always the first thing that I do. I have to make sure that all my images have the same color temperature. In other words, having the same color balance. Now you saw me shooting a color checker. Now in the past, the color checker only worked in Lightroom, or in other words, with DCP profiling. Nowadays there's new software. Let me very quickly show you. I'm not going to show you how it works for the very simple reason. It's incredibly simple. And we will do a new video on that very soon. But if I now drag the solver here, you can now actually see that in the past we had DNG and dual illuminated, aluminum DNG, mouthful. But we also now have ICC, and that means that we now actually can use the color checker passport also for Capture One or any other solver that uses ICC profiling. Okay, let me set everything up for the retouch part, because now we have proper color balance. Let me just select an image that I really like. So. What I always do with my images when I select is just go through them really fast, and the image that I like will actually show up immediately, like, hey, I love this. So I love this. Oh, this one is really nice. This one is cool. And that one is awesome, of course. Okay. Okay. Sort on rating. You can do the same thing, of course, in Lightroom. Now, this is one thing I have to stress with you guys. Lightroom and Capture One are, of course, competitors. But in essence, when I use Capture One, all the tips that I show you, you can also use in Lightroom. Jeremy, you had a question.
Yeah, no details from monitor.
No details from the monitor. Okay, this is something that... okay, I see another one going from the video had low quality. Hey, I don't know what's going on. When I see the preview window here from Lightroom, from YouTube, it looks absolutely sharp. So I don't see any low quality. I have to be honest, when we look back, we do sometimes see that it's a low quality. And if we refresh, it's okay. Is this something we're working on? So let me just work that out, and we're going to file. If this is still the same thing, I'm going to tell you, last time we had somebody that said that the letters were really unsharp. We actually upped the bandwidth with 10 times the bandwidth we used before. So now we're on 100 megabits fiber, and we're actually outputting almost 50 megabits to YouTube and 50 megabits to Facebook. So there's absolutely no reason why the quality shouldn't be 1080p. So that's, I'm very sorry if it looks bad. If it looks bad, we are going to solve that for the next time, I hope. And we're going to do a, how do you call it? A ticket with Wirecast, because that would be absolutely ridiculous. Outputting 50 megabytes and then still have bad quality. Do you see the same quality on Facebook, or does it look right, Jeremy?
I'm not checking it on low quality.
Just go to high quality on Facebook?
Yeah.
So you can see all the letters? Okay, it's kind of hard to read. Okay, sorry guys, we will be working up. Okay, I will. Oh, somebody said Glyn Dewis had this problem and fixed it. Don't know what he did. I will ask Glyn. So I will speak to Glyn about that. Looks fine from Tennessee. Yeah, that's what I mean. Some people say it looks fine, it's very sharp. Some people say it's fuzzy as it can be. I really don't know, guys. We are offering this for you guys. We are working on it every time. Just drop me an email with a screenshot so we have proof that we can actually give to Wirecast. But again, we are already outputting at 50 megabytes, and we are outputting on a very, very high quality. So I don't know what's going on. I'm very sorry for that, guys. Okay, let me go. Let me continue for now. Let me see if there's another question. How important is it to change your color checker passport? Okay, Martin, it's very important that every 2 or 3 years you change your color checker passport. There's actually no trick to this. It's very simple. They just degrade over time. If you do a lot of outside shoots and you just leave it open in the sun, it will probably be like a week and you can change it. If you only do studio work, you open it up and you close it immediately, maybe it will work for 4 or 5 years. My advice, every 2 or 3 years, just change it. And if you think like, hey, it doesn't look right, just change it. Let me see. Okay, no more questions. Okay, let me just go to Photoshop really fast. So we have this original shot. And the reason I got this one, because this one I won't retouch, or I can retouch it. Let me just retouch it, just for fun. Okay, let me just go to Photoshop very quickly and just show you the difference. Okay. Okay, Photoshop is now starting. So you guys should see it in a second. Now you guys make me nervous. Okay, there we go. Okay, let's go to 100%. Now the first thing you will notice is that when I go to 100%, the dress absolutely looks like it should look. And the face absolutely also looks like it should look. Now never zoom in to 100% if your model is with you. For the very simple reason, these cameras are really, really sharp. What I always do is I use one filter a lot, and that's Imagenomic Portraiture. That's not because I'm lazy, but it's because I want to save time and I'm lazy. So let me just change this very quickly to here so I don't look like a talking face. Okay, let's go to 100% very quickly and just go here. Now what you can see is that Imagenomic Portraiture actually already smoothens out the skin amazingly, but way, way too much. Now what I do, and I've started doing this a few weeks ago, I actually always start out at 100% and then later just back it down. Okay, Anouk, you have a question from Facebook.
It's always new to make new profile with color checker. Every photo shoot, new profile.
Okay, is it necessary to make a new profile for every single shot with a color checker passport? Yes and no. In essence, yes. In essence, no. What do I mean? Why is it yes? Why is it no? Very simple. If you are really, really picky and you want to make sure that everything is 100% accurate, you have to take a color checker passport every time you change the light output, you change your modifier, you change the backdrop, you change the colors, you change clothing, you have to do a new color checker passport shot. In essence, what you do with a color checker passport is you create a profile for your sensor. Got it? For your sensor. The sensor doesn't change if you change your light setup. It's the same as if you calibrate your monitor. If you see a red image, you don't need to recalibrate your monitor. If you see a blue image, you don't have to recalibrate your monitor. With the color checker passport, it doesn't really work like that, because in the studio, we have a lot of problems with bounce light. We have a lot of problems with infection from the backdrops. We have a lot of problems with, for example, the clothing. And creating a color checker passport profile is incredibly simple and goes really, really fast. In Lightroom, it's totally automated. In Capture One, it's like maybe 2 or 3 minutes in which you can do it. So yes, you have to create a new color checker passport setting for everything. What I do is if you go into Capture One, let me go to Capture One very quickly. And if I go to my color settings, you can actually see that we have an ICC profile. And this profile, I created two, these two. And one is actually for a little bit underexposed and one is for a little bit normal. A little bit normal. One is for normal and one I created for a special purpose. So this is why we actually have two in here. And I actually always use the one that you see now, always, because that's my sensor. The thing that I do is I do shoot a color checker every time I need accurate colors, but then I only use it as a white balance card. Now you might wonder, why not shoot a white balance card? Guys, we already have that color checker passport. If for one reason or another I need to create a profile later on, I can still use that color checker passport. So that's why we always use that color checker. How many times did I say color checker passport? Compete and win. That's a joke. Okay, so there's way too much smoothing going on. So what we do is layer mask, hide all. So let's first take everything off. Oops, let's make sure that it's right. We have a black piece of paper, and it means that if we use a white pen, we actually can get that effect back. Let me see, because there's a lot of questions coming in. It's about the image quality. And again, guys, sorry if the image quality is bad. We are really working on it. We thought we tackled it by just giving up all our bandwidth to YouTube, but as it seems now, something is going on, because in my preview, it absolutely looks razor sharp. And somebody from Tennessee just confirmed it looks great. So I'm stunned. Sorry. We will work on it. Just send us screenshots where you can see that it's blurry, and we will make work of it. Trust me. Okay. So I have white stuff, white paint. The first thing I'm going to do is everything where I want 100%, I'm just going to paint in very sloppy. So there we go. So there are certain areas where you want 100% smoothing. And it depends a little bit per model where you want this. Now, in the neck, etc., I always want 100% smoothing. But that's because I like that really, really nice soft look. Everywhere else where I now left it, I will actually pull my opacity down to, let's say, 40%. And that's where I will draw in a little bit less. Now, again, on YouTube, this might seem like I'm overdoing it a lot over here. I still have a lot of detail in the pores. It just looks very, very good. Okay, nice. Okay, do a layer flatten image. I'm done with this. Want to make the eyes pop just a little bit, so I'm going to use the dodge tool, and I'm going to use it on highlights. There we go. And only do it on the iris. Don't do it on the eye white. There we go. And fit on screen, and we're done. Looks pretty good. File close. Now, what you saw me do is actually a lot of work. So I have to do the skin, and I have to do the skin on 100% because otherwise it doesn't look right. I want to make the eyes pop a little bit more. And then I end up with an image that actually looks pretty normal. Okay, no problem at all. Let's go back to Capture One. And let's take one of the shots where I actually overexposed it a little bit. Let's go for that one. Let's go for that one first. As you can see, the dress is on the brink of overexposing. But you can still bring it back. Look at this. When I go to highlights, there we go. All the detail is back. So just last. Now I can actually mix it. And there we go. I actually like that little porcelain look. Go to D. And this is the cool thing when you use a light meter. I know for 100% certainty I can get that detail back. I don't need anything else. Okay, let me see what's going on here. Let me just turn that off. There we go. Awesome. Thank you. That was my phone. Okay, now let's look at that face. So go to view 100%. Now, first of all, it looks a little bit more fresh, but look at the face. It looks a little bit more smoothened out. Now the only thing I have to do is do the same thing. Portrait smooth very quickly. The eyes already pop. And it just already looks a little bit more fresh. Now, just leave it on 40% first, so you can see what 40% does. It only smoothens a little bit. Don't lift up your pen, because the moment you lift up your pen, it starts adding another 40%. So it's actually cumulative, or how do you call that? There we go. Okay. Now I go to 100%, and I only do the areas where I want 100% smoothing, and that's often the forehead. And here. A little bit here. And as I said before, the neck. The neck I always smooth a lot. Again, this is very personal. If you say, hey Frank, I don't like anything with smoothing, more power to you. Don't use it. Okay, there we go. Do I still need to pop the eyes? Actually, no, but let's do it just a little bit, just for fun, to show you guys how little I now need. Just a little bit of a touch. And there we go. And this looks already more retouched, you know? The first shot was the proper exposure. It looked great. The second shot, however, looks way more on the mark. Like, it's already looking like a retouched image. It looks fresh. It looks a little bit... It's not blown out, but it looks like it's already retouched by a professional. Anyway, so the cool thing about, and I hope you guys got that, is that when you use that reflective metering, I know exactly how much I can overexpose. How many times did it happen to you guys that you are in a situation like this? You want to overexpose it, and you go a little bit too far, and you lose detail. Or you go like, oh, I could have done one stop more. By using that reflective meter, I know exactly how far I can push that dress. The cool thing about the reflective meter is it doesn't discriminate what kind of dress the model is wearing. It could be a pure white dress. Only at that time, I could only open maybe half a stop. It could be a little bit darker dress, and then maybe I can overexpose two stops instead of one and a half. Using that reflective meter gives you the perfect exposure, but also your perfect latitude for if you want to change that shot. Now, this is something I tell you guys a lot. The light meter doesn't dictate you that you have to shoot on f8. It gives you the proper exposure. So it gives you the perfect exposure. But often in retouching, you don't want the proper or perfect exposure. You want an exposure that's a little bit more daring, a little bit more over the top. And that's actually what we do now. Okay, now as soon as you start working with stuff like this, you will see that retouching becomes a lot easier. Because now I go to capture one, I take, for example, this shot, I do the same thing, I just bring back a little bit of that detail, but still keep that crispiness in. And of course, what you can also do, if you say, hey, I don't want that, just leave it there, and in Lightroom, use the adjustment brush, and here we can just use the brush, just paint it in, and again, in Lightroom, it's called the adjustment brush, here it's just the brush, and you can only do it on that area. There you go, now the face is unaffected, do you see that? And because I'm using that light meter again, I know exactly how far I can push those files. So it's not really something that it dictates. It just gives you that proper exposure. Okay, go into Photoshop. And the only thing I have to do is do my portrait smooth, my action. Take my brush with white paint. Go up. First do everything on 100%. Just depends on how my mood is, if I start with 100 or with 40%. Just paint everything in that you want 100. There we go. And then just pull it back to, let's say, 50. And just go over here, because this was a little bit more contrasty, so I need a little bit more. There we go.
Hey, Frank.
The eyes just a little bit, so layer, flatten image.
There are some questions about the color checker.
Okay, just give me the question.
Why has the color checker so many different colors? And also different white, gray tints, but also red, yellow, etc.
Okay, let me switch over to full screen and I can explain it to you. Can you give me the color checker, Annemiek? Okay. So, this is the color checker. Now, you have to realize, when you shoot a color checker, there's a lot of stuff going on. First of all, on top here, we have all these white, grayish, black. Those are one for your dynamic range. Two, those are actually also very handy if you want to do a proper white balance. I always advise to do this one, so the third one, not the other ones, because this is too much too white. And what can happen in white? You have to realize that in photography, we see three colors, red, green, and blue. Those are your channels. Now, one of those channels can be blown out, and you can still see a great image, and you can still get detail back. If you do color balance on pure white, it can be that, for example, green is overexposed by, let's say, 10%. This is something that can happen a lot. Your green channel is blown by 10%. That will mean if you do your color balance on that white one, you will have 10% too little green, or actually 10% too much green in the end result, because it's clipping. But as soon as you start going down in the grayscale, it will actually show up. If you go too much to the other side, if you go here, that's black, there's a lot of noise. So that means that if you go for the darker colors, you could actually, by accident, hit one of the noise particles. In modern day cameras, it doesn't make any sense, but you know what I mean, right? Just take the middle one that's a little bit lighter and you're done. Okay, so the other ones, very simple. If you look at the color triangle, we have three primary colors, red, green, and blue. We also have three secondary colors, cyan, magenta, yellow. In the middle, there's a black body curve, and let me just do it very, very simple for you guys. So let me just switch over here. Okay, let me just do new. This is the cool thing about Digital Classroom, guys. Ask those questions. Okay, so let me just draw it very quickly. I'm going to do it two-dimensional to not make it too difficult. Now, I have to be honest, this is one of the things that I love to talk about. So let's do a two-dimensional color space. Okay, this is green. I'm doing it wrong. Sorry, guys. I have to flip this one over too. Okay, let me do it like this. So there we go. This is green. This is blue. And this is red. Okay. Now, at one point, Kelvin, a very famous guy, of course, he invented something called the color temperatures. He put a black piece of metal into the fire and he saw it going from reddish to, well, white, and he went to blue. Now, in the Netherlands, there is actually an expression, I'm wit heet, or in other words, I'm white hot. That means I'm very, very angry. In essence, that's not so angry at all, because blue is in color temperature higher than white. So if you want to be really angry, you have to be, I'm a smurf. Because if you're a smurf, you're blue, you're really, really angry. So anyway, that black body curve goes a little bit like this on your color space. That means that everything in this area can be considered as semi-white. So it's not white, but it's semi-white. Now, of course, we have to have a reference point, right? Now, for calibrations, you often see this, D65 or 6500 or sometimes 6.5K, which you hardly ever see because this is actually wrong. And sometimes you see K6500, which is correct. And sometimes you see this, K65, which is also incorrect. But most of the times you see this one or you actually see this one. This is the point where we calibrate our monitors, and this point is a little bit off the black body curve. It's actually almost here. So this is your D point, and that actually is your white point. This is where we calibrate. This is the point where if you shoot something that is white, it is actually in that area. So white fluffy clouds are all around that black body curve, around that D6500 points. Clouds are mostly like in the 5500, but don't make it too difficult. Okay, now I talked about the primaries, now let's talk about the secondary colors. Secondary colors are really, really simple, but you have to beware for something. If we go from red through that white point, we actually end up here. And this, believe it or not, is cyan. If we go from green to the white point, oops, it should be a straight line. A little bit too much to drink yesterday. This is magenta. Now, if we go from blue to that white point, through the white point, see, this is yellow. Okay, so now we have a color space that's actually 100% in balance. And this is how you calibrate. Now, if you look at your color checker, let me see where it is. Now, let's go to the color checker. The first thing you will notice is that on the color checker, you actually see red, green, blue, cyan, magenta, and yellow. So already six of those are your primary colors. But it's something more. We have skin tones, we have voilage, we have certain areas of, for example, skin that are a little bit more towards pink. And that's why they also include some other colors in that color checker. Okay, so what does it do? How does it work? Why is it important? Well, okay, let me just go there. Let me just first delete everything here. Let's go new. Okay, create. Okay, so we have one lab table. I hope this you guys like hearing this stuff. The lab table gives you three coordinates, x, y, and a big y. This one is called saturation. This one is called U. And this one is called luminance. Remember, three-dimensional color space. Every single color has a coordinate. For example, you can have a coordinate of 309 by 336 by, for example, 208. I don't know. I just write something down. Now, if you look at why you need to calibrate your monitor, why you need to do this, why you need to do that, you have to go a little bit back. Remember that in Photoshop and Lightroom and Capture One, you have color spaces. Now, the most known ones are sRGB, Adobe RGB, and for example, Profoto RGB. Okay, now one might say this is sRGB, Adobe RGB, Profoto RGB. So the color spaces get bigger. Now this is a really bad way of drawing it because again, it's a three-dimensional color space, and if you ever saw it, it isn't a triangle, but it's more like this. And then three-dimensional, so I'm really bad. Cory Barker helped me out with three-dimensional drawing, but something like that. Don't show him. Anyway, so it's a three-dimensional color space. Now, How do you work with that? We have a camera, we have a monitor, we have a printer, and of course we want, if we shoot something with a camera, we want to make sure that it looks nice on the monitor. Now, if we retouch something in, let's say, Adobe RGB, and for internet we want to convert that to sRGB, we want to make sure that everything looks the same. Now, of course, reds will be a little bit less red because it's a smaller color space, greens will be a little, etc., right? Now, you also realize that you can't go from a small color space to a big color space without losing stuff. So that's first. So always go down. So go from Pro Photo to sRGB, to Adobe RGB to sRGB. Now, why that color checker? Why do you do that stuff? Everything is fixed. So in that lab table, this table, we have fixed for every single color space, we have the fixed coordinates. So the computer knows that, for example, it should be this. The software will look at that little square and will see, for example, 306, 306, and 202. Yes? It isn't right, right? It's wrong. So what it does, it will calculate here that it needs plus 3, plus 30, plus 6. And this correction is called ICC profiling. In a nutshell, it's a little bit more complicated than that. So now you have an ICC profile, but it has to know for which color space. And that's actually what happens in the computer. It calculates that to the computer. So you need that lab table, you need that color space, you need those coordinates, and you need that ICC profiling. And this, ladies and gentlemen, everything I now explained, and which probably for a lot of people will go like, yeah, you just shoot this thing and everything goes automatically, or in front of your monitor you just put a color analyzer and everything goes automatically too. So it's a really, really simple way of working. The cool thing is, if you know this stuff, and that's always what I tell people, if you know lighting, if you know how a light meter works, if something goes wrong, you actually know where it goes wrong. So if this digital classroom goes a little bit too fast on the technical stuff, re-watch it or ask questions below so I can help you guys. Because this is really important to understand if you have a problem in your workflow or if colors doesn't look right. Like, let me see hands. Which one of you guys ever uploaded something to internet and it looked too brownish? So everything you retouched, it looks great. You upload it to internet and it looks brown. Mm-hmm. See a lot of hands, including myself when I started out. The thing is, you need color management. And if you upload something to internet in Adobe RGB, the computer isn't color managed. So it will interpret Adobe RGB as sRGB and it will just mess up. So if you do your stuff for internet, make sure you upload on sRGB. Now some guys will say, hey Frank, I'm using a Mac. The Mac is totally color calibrated. Safari is totally calibrated. I don't want to do sRGB. I want to do, well, the stuff that is Adobe RGB. Remember, there are also people that work on non-color managed systems. So you really need to do that stuff. Anyway, are there any questions on Facebook?
Well, there's another interesting question, and that's from William. Is it always necessary to make a new profile with the color checker? Every photo shoot a new profile?
I just explained the color checker profiling is done for the sensor. So yes, you need to do a new color checker passport profile every time. No, you don't need it if you're not too picky. White balance is incredibly important. You need to do your white balance for every single shot. Even if you are doing it creatively, white balance should be done for every single shot. The color checker profile, outside I always do it. Inside, I have to be honest, I'm incredibly lazy. I do it once every single while and then I create a new profile and I find out that they're actually, especially with high quality strobes like we did with Ellen Grom, we now do with Hensel, I've shot with Profoto and Broncolor. Those brands, guys, it doesn't really matter. The profiling is the same. As soon as I go to the cheaper brands, there's actually a difference between low output and high output, medium output, and it can be that tomorrow there's a little bit difference. So just look at the quality of your strobes, and that's very simply put. Just put a gray card in, shoot 10 or 20 frames. If there's a difference between 10 or 20 frames, just use that color checker every time you take a photo shoot. Do remember, it's about having it perfect. A lot of people don't need perfect. A lot of people just want a great shot. If you don't need perfect, fine. Don't use a color checker passport. It's work. It's 1 minute in Lightroom, 2 minutes in Capture One. But It's up to you. If you want it perfect, use it. If you say, hey, it's good enough, do color balance. If you say, I don't care at all, don't do any of it. If you don't want to do photography, what the heck are you watching this for? So, I'm just kidding with you, don't worry. Okay, let me see. Any questions on Facebook? No. Okay, I promised you guys something about the light meter, the video. I'm going to show you that now because we have to take a little break to actually set up everything for the next shot. And the next shot is going to rock, trust me. So let me just show you that video for the light meter if I can find it. There we go. Hey guys, my name is Frank Dorov and I'm the author of the book Mastering the Model Shoot. Now, you guys really like the book because we're getting a lot of rave reviews on Amazon and every other online store. So that actually triggered us to make a video series about the book. Now, in the first video, I will tell you everything about the light meter. Now, in digital photography, I think the light meter is the one thing that confuses people a lot. Shouldn't I use the histogram, Frank? Isn't there a meter inside the camera? Where do I point the meter? Towards the pretty girl? Towards the camera? Towards the light source? Where? There's a lot of confusion out there. Now, in this video, I will give you in more than 70 minutes all the insights out about the light meter. Calibrating, using incident and reflective, using a white background, how to keep details in the black, how to trigger the meter, where to point the meter. You will see everything very easily explained, but you will also see photo shoots including our model Manon. This is one of the videos if you're slightly interested in the light meter, or if you already have a light meter and you want to know everything about it, get this video. It's called Mastering the Model Shoot, the Light Meter, and it's the first video in a whole series that we're going to release in connection to our book Mastering the Model Shoot, and it's available now from our website. And welcome to our studio in Emerald. My name is Frank Dorov, and today I want to talk to you guys about something that we get a lot of questions about. Hey Frank, how do you like this image? Hey Frank, what can I improve in this image? And of course, I love to help you guys out. But online, I mostly am limited to just saying, hey, I really like it, or continue like this, or change this. I can only do short images because, let's be honest, we get so many questions. So that's what actually got us thinking. And we started a Patreon. Now, what is a Patreon? Well, let me put it this way. Do you want an extensive photo critique every month? Do you want the bed phone, where you can directly contact me with any questions you have? Do you want to be a member of a group that's closed off on Facebook that have the same interest as you guys? That isn't about putting people down, but it's actually about helping people progress in their photography and retouching. Well, that's our Patreon. Now, by joining our Patreon, every month you can deliver one or two images. We're not that strict about it. And I will do a whole video. In that video, I will show you how I would do the retouching, what I would change about the shot, and I give you a whole lot of tips. That video is put online on a closed-off website. And it means that only the guys from Patreon can see that video and help you out. So I help you out, and the whole community helps you out. It's just an awesome way to learn. So, if you like what we do, of course, the first thing you can do is subscribe to our channels, leave comments, and smash that like button because we really like it, and tell other people about it. But if you want to do a little bit more and help us out creating the awesome programs you enjoy, like Behind the Closed Doors, Digital Classroom, quite frankly, our upcoming podcast, Beyond Photography with the Dorhoffs, and a lot more, then please join our Patreon. I already know you're absolutely gonna love it. So head on over to the link below and start joining our awesome group on Patreon and get a lot of benefits. Thank you so very much for supporting our work. See you online. Hey guys, and welcome to our studio in Emerald. My name is Frank Dorov, and today I want to talk to you guys about something that we get a lot of questions. Okay guys, we did something wrong with the videos. I'm so sorry for that. I tried to do something smart and, well, as they always say, don't try to do anything smart because then it goes wrong. Okay, so we have Nadine on the set. So we have a different setup now. You see me changing the modifiers. I now have a 90 centimeter Hensel Grant with a light tools grid. And we have Nadine on a chair. And we're going to do something completely different for this setup. And this is going to be a little bit more challenging and a little bit more interesting. So let me just walk there and we will sit behind my desk. And let me see if we still have connection with the camera. Okay. On. Okay, first things first. Of course, first we're going to meter the light on our model, Nadine. Oh, Nadine, you look awesome. But I'm now having my light set up under a straight angle down. And it's not straight. Let me put it this way. I want a little bit more extreme angle. Is this better, Annemiek?
No, you're fine.
Oh. Jeremy was in the picture. I thought the camera was too low. Okay. So, for a wedding, I would like it like this. If I do a fashion shot, I would actually just aim that light a little bit more higher and aim it more down, so you get a little bit more stark image. But in this case, this is fine. The only thing, because I want a little bit more contrast, is I'm going to move it more to the side. There we go. Aim the hotspot. Do your meter reading. 2.84. And that's because I'm still on reflective metering. Make sure you switch that back to incident. 16.9, which we call friture. Or in other words, what's the American term for friture?
Deep frying.
Deep frying. So we don't want that, so just go down. There we go. Okay. Just wait for the stroke to release. There we go. 5.68, so go up 1.2. Now you might say, Frank, why didn't you just take some test shots? Well, normally we meter the light before our talent is on set. So it means he sits down, we do one quick meter reading, and it's done. If you take test shots, well, you don't look like a professional, right? Okay, F8. Was it F8? Yeah. I talk too much. Okay, let's sit down. Let's go for F8. So I'm just going to do it under a low angle. I'm using my flip-up screen, which I absolutely love. Focus on my model and just take the shot. I can always clone stuff out. And I have this beautiful, almost surreal look. And that's because I'm now using grids, so I'm really narrowing that light beam. Chin up just a little bit, Nadine. There we go. And of course on Sony you can use the OK button and have auto eye focus. So we'll just find the face of the model. Oh, this is really cool if you work on a tripod and you don't want to move the camera around too much, you just press the OK button. Doesn't work on all lenses, doesn't work all the time. But it's a really cool feature. Okay, cool. Okay, so now we have a high contrast look, and this is something that not a lot of people will love for their wedding photography. So this is something we add actually a little bit. But I can also make it a little bit more interesting by just moving myself here, and now I can make it a little bit more flat. Can you look a little bit that way? Perfect. That's really nice. Cool. And of course, if you want it really, really high contrast, this is why we use these seats. You can also go here and then just clone the light box out. Cool, so I can move around my model and get some really, really cool stuff. Now, if I fall down, I will probably go viral on YouTube. So, do you want to go viral on YouTube? Nah, we have to make it nice. You see another light there. What you can do is you can create something really nice and stark. And that's actually with adding one extra light from the back. Now this is a trick you see me doing a lot because I just absolutely love it. And this is also one of the reasons why you should have boom stands in your studio. So you just put one light source. Don't go over the dress. Well, a little bit. Always say don't go over the dress and then just do it, because then the model thinks that you don't go over the dress. Right, Nadine? Mm-hmm. And Nadine and I go way back, like behind that curtain back. Okay? I don't know what I'm saying. Don't worry. So just move it over here and just tighten this. There we go. And also make sure that this is tightened. And now I'm going to aim it just slightly down Oops. There we go. Turn it on. And I'm going to aim it away from my model. So I'm looking now, and she's just going to get a little bit of light. So not too much. And I'm actually aiming towards. Now, if I aim it straight at my model, it will look like this. And this will blow out in the final picture. If I do this, I'm using the sides of my light. It hardly hits the model, but it will hit my lens straight on. So I don't know how hard I will put it or how much power. Let me just see. I'm going to go here and go low. There we go. I really like this. It's a little bit too bright. So let's just turn it down like one or two stops. There we go. The cool thing about these Hensels is they're really, really fast and really powerful. So you have a lot of options to change the power output from really low to really high. We call that stops of dynamic range. Very important when you buy a strobe. Don't buy a strobe with three or four stops. Just buy a strobe with at least five. There we go. Love this. Nice. So you go from that really, really high contrast shot to something that's almost overblown on the sides and gives you a little bit, well, this is still too much. Let's go down even more. There we go. Now you don't see me using a meter reader for this, and this is very simple. This is for me always taste. There we go, this is cool. Because I want that darker area on our side. And now, of course, I have to clone some stuff out. But how about a full body shot like this? Wow. Love it. In a moment, I'm going to show you how you clone that stuff out. Can you tilt your head that way? Perfect. Okay, let's move to that high contrast setting over here. And let's see if that works. Now, you will see something really weird happening. In this setup, it doesn't work. Do you see that? That's weird, right? And that's actually not so weird. If you understand what lens flare does, let me see if I can stand somewhere in a camera, that camera. Lens flare is actually hitting light on your sensor, and the lens will scatter it around. That's also why I aim that light so it's a little bit down. When I'm sitting there, that light doesn't hit my sensor or my lens. So that means that I don't have any lens flare. At that point, I just have a light in the back. If I'm under the right angle, if I'm under the right angle, like here, now I get a beautiful lens flare. Okay, let's spice this up a little bit and a week. Okay, put a blue gel in front.
The stand is blocking the video, Frank. You're behind the pole of the reflector. So, can you please stand?
Can you put a blue gel on it?
Yes, I will.
Okay. Which pole? Just move the camera. Okay, guys, come on. Blue gel. Okay, so what we're now going to do is we're going to add a little bit of color to that strobe. By using colors, you can actually just spice up that shot even more. Now, of course, you can do it in Photoshop. You can do it, well, wherever you want it. But by having it in that shot, it just spices it up a little bit. So you can use a red, you can use green, you can use whatever color you want. In my case, I actually love doing blue. Anavi, can you add about one stop on the strobe? 10 clicks. Now, why do I add one more stop? For the very simple reason, a gel always takes away a little bit of light. And I know from these gels, they take away approximately one stop. So we're going to add one stop. And there we go. Now we have a blue side. And it gives a totally different look to the shot. Making it way more interesting, way more spacey, way more dreamy. Now imagine being a bride and getting shots like this. Now don't say you don't like this, guys. Isn't this just pretty awesome? I want to be a bride. No. Cool. I always take a few extra, or a lot extra. Sorry. That's my mistake. There we go. Awesome. Nadine, can you tilt your body a little bit that way? Perfect. Yes. I love the flowers like that. And of course also do some close-ups, like we do here. Awesome, love it. Make sure your model keeps looking towards the light. And if she doesn't do it, don't correct it. Just take 3 or 4 shots and say, okay, now try towards the light, because we always want to keep that positive drive in our shots. Awesome, thank you so very much, Nadine. Oh, wait a minute, stay. I want to try one more little thing. Can you look towards the camera, please? Maybe it works, maybe it doesn't, but it can give you a really cool perspective. That's okay. Thank you. Okay, let's see what we can do with these shots. And then let's see if we have any more questions from you guys. Oh, Annemiek, you have a question?
Yeah, there's a question about tethering.
Okay, about tethering.
It's from our friend from Norway, John Andre.
Okay.
And he's also trying to shoot tethered through Capture One. Try to use Capture One, but cannot find any way to store the images on the memory card in the camera while shooting tethered. Am I doing something wrong, or is it just the way things work with Capture One?
No, you're not doing anything wrong. That's indeed the way Capture One works. You can't store images on the card and on the computer. It's very simple. You store it on the computer with Capture One and not on the card. I still advise you guys to have a card in the camera, because if you lose connection to Capture One, you can very simply just, well, shoot on the card at that point. If you don't have a card in the camera and you find out after your killer shot or 10 killer shots, you find out that Capture One lost connection or your computer crashed or whatever, you did lose all those images. If you have a card in the camera, as soon as Capture One detects the camera, all the images will go to Capture One. As soon as Capture One doesn't connect, at that point, all the images will go to your card. So always shoot with the card, but in essence, all the files will be on Capture One and not on your card. Let me see, we also have a question here. Work on a tripod. One of the things you taught me was to work around the model. Shocking, just shocking. Alan, Mr. Dixon, Alan Dixon, Dixon Alan, you are absolutely right. I don't work on a tripod. I don't want to work on a tripod. It's just that some people, and it's not us, Alan, some people love to work on a tripod. And also imagine that, for example, you're doing what we have with Hensel. We have the free mask system. Free mask system, I will do a video on that one. I already did, by the way. With the free mask system, you shoot 2 times. One, you shoot the front area. 2, you shoot the back. And those two are combined in software, and you have the perfect cutout, for example, for compositing. At that point, you have to shoot from a tripod for the very simple reason it's impossible to shoot that handheld, because if you only move just a little bit, the masking won't work. Now, if you shoot it on a tripod and you do center focus, you're always focusing on the chest of the model, or you have to make sure that the face of the model is in the center of the frame, meaning you lose resolution. By using the Sony auto eye system, so eye focus system, you just press OK and it will find the face in the frame, focus on the frame, and you're done. Normally, for example, schools where you work on tripods, or if you do what we over here call Facebooks, and it's not Facebook, the social media network, it's Facebooks for companies. Smulebook is the Dutch term. Then you often work on a tripod for the very simple reason you're standing there all day, you have to shoot 100 people. Just put it on a freaking tripod and just go. And at that point, because everybody's a little bit taller or shorter, and you want the same backdrop, you just use eye focus, and then you shoot on a tripod. Awesome. Every time else, Alan, you're absolutely right. You just move around your model. That's what I learn everybody. And still, I love tripods, by the way, but not for model photography. I'm a big, big fan of the Benro carbon fiber tripod. I love that one. And the thing about tripods, and I want to give you a little bit of an insight here. I never, ever use tripods. But I always had a tripod. I have my whole closet filled with tripods and bags. We all have, right? Like women have their shoes, we have our bags and tripods. The thing is, when I found a tripod that was light, it wasn't stable. So I brought it to America for skyline photos of New York, and all my skyline photos were moving because the tripod wasn't stable. Then I found a tripod that was really stable, but I couldn't bring it with me because it was way too heavy. And at one point, you know, when you add up all the costs you have from those tripods, just go for the carbon fiber. We now have a Benro carbon fiber here, and in all honesty, I bring it with me everywhere. And in every trip, at least 1 or 2 times, I use it and I get that shot that I normally would never ever get. Just because it's a carbon fiber. It's very stable, it's very sturdy, and it's incredibly light. So yes, there's a place for tripods, especially in bad neighborhoods. Carbon fiber just gives you that little bit of a swing. I'm just kidding. Okay, anyway, do we have anything else? Oh, Alan Dixon just lost internet for a couple of minutes. You missed the fun part I made with your name, dude. You have to watch it in the rerun. Okay, let me see if we have any other questions. Do we have questions on Facebook? Anouk? What kind of comment? Is something I have to answer or?
No.
No, not something I need to answer. Okay, then I will read it later. Okay, let me see what we got. So we go to our desktop. Let's switch over. Okay, so I actually like this shot. I don't know why, but it's just, it's a little bit quirky and I love that. And let me see which one I like more. I like it when there's also a little bit of sight light. Oh, I love this one. Look at the angles. I just love the angles here. I have to watch also my monitor. Yes, okay, everything is still going right. And now, when I'm honest, if I look at the shots I took without that blue gel, I just don't like those anymore. So this is with the blue gel, and this is without. I just think they're boring. And now look at the shots we took without that extra light. Okay, this is pretty interesting. These I actually really like. So give it 5 stars. These are okay, but they're not like stunning shots. Oh, I like this one. Okay, so when I sort on rating, I actually go back here and I have 1, 2, 3, 4 that I really, really like. And I have to find one more. Oh, here we have one with the whole dress. Okay, so how do we take stuff out? Let's just go for... this one isn't... Let's just go for this one very quickly. Okay, Control D, go to Photoshop. Okay, so taking the big softbox out isn't really difficult, but we also have something here, we have something here behind the flowers, and we have, well, nothing else. Okay, that's cool. Okay, just take your lasso tool and just select this, and just take that out. And just press delete, content aware fill, that's so cool about Photoshop nowadays. And you just take it out. Okay, now do a deselect, and now just go into 100%. And now what I always do is I will find out where I have a problem. The only problem you have, and this is a real problem, is it's really dark, so you can't see what you're doing. Now watch this. You can make a new layer. And of course, clone there and then later compare. But there's another trick. Let me see if that works. So we do this. We do a duplicate layer. We go into image adjustments and we go into curves. I'm just going to pull this up. So now I can see all the problems that I have. Now I can take my healing brush and put it on all layers for sampling. Oops, sorry. And now when I take it out and I do this, you will see that it's not gone on the bottom layer. So if you want to do something like this, what I normally do is I will first do all the selections, and then later on I will copy one layer like this on top, and then I can literally see where everything is. What you can also do is this. So I do undo. Oh, do it again. Now I can see where my problems are. And of course I can just clone blind underneath by just pulling down the opacity on this one. And every time I can just pull up the opacity and see if the problem is gone. So here we go. So we're going to do this. And just pull down. There we go. Now I can see what I've done. And take that one out. Okay. That's just a little trick in between. And it doesn't work for everything, but sometimes it can just be that little bit of an extra help. But overall, I will just judge on the monitors. Sometimes we use that extra layer if it's something that's really important or something that's really tricky. But for this is relatively simple. We just do it like this. Okay, now we have a part where I'm actually a little bit more afraid, so we're going to skip that part. I'm going to do this. There we go. Now, this is fading out. As you can see, there's a little bit of a a fade effect. So what I will do is I will literally just go here with the Alt key and just go over there. And then just make that a little bit smoother. There we go. Okay. Same thing here. Go to 100%. Sorry, 200%. And just use the clone tool for this part. Now some people will say, why not leave it in? Well, you can do it, but I like to do it a little bit more nicer for this kind of stuff. Okay, so we're left actually with... where was it? Here. We're left with this part, which is very, very tricky. Because it's in between stuff. I can do it a little bit like this with the clone tool. But there's all that stuff in between. Now, of course, you can spend a lot of time on it. But there's one thing that I always like to try with this. And let's go to Quick Mask. Take a brush and just paint in your mask. Make sure that you're on 100%. And just do it like this. Paint in your mask. There we go. Now unclick, and now this is selected. Now some people will go like, hey, with me I have to do an inverse. That's true. Out of the box, just double click here. Out of the box you will see that masked areas is lit. I have selected areas. I don't know why Adobe actually does it the other way around. Standard out of the box. I actually like it like this. Okay, so do it like this. Now everything is selected. Now the only thing I have to do is press delete and just, well, hope that Lightroom, or sorry, Photoshop actually does it right. And as you can see here, this looks pretty nice. There's a little bit of a problem there. But overall, Photoshop is getting better and better with content-aware fill. There we go, just fill that up and just smooth it out. Now you don't have to be too picky about it, let's be honest. I'm now on 200% on a 42 megapixel file. Nobody will see it. Even if I go to 100%, now everything looks perfect. Okay, fine. So I deleted everything. Let me see here underneath. I don't like that. So let's take that out too. Cool. Now the hairs. As you can see, we have a lot of stray hairs. We have here, we have here, we have here. Of course, we can now just go on and just take all those stray hairs out. But we can use the same trick with that Quick Mask. Just go into Quick Mask, take your brush. And this is something that will save you a bundle of time when you do a lot of this stuff. And just with your Quick Mask, make the brush just a little bit, a little bit bigger. Not too much. A little bit bigger. There we go. Okay, let me take that one out. Leave a few in because we have to make sure that it looks convincible, that it's real. And not too much. Okay. Let's go here. Now make the brush a little bit smaller because this hair is actually smaller. There we go. Same here. This will take a little bit of time. I'm not going to do everything, but as long as you get what I mean. There we go. Take this one. And go. Okay, more than enough for this. Okay, maybe this one. That's the problem. I never know when to quit. Okay, done. And now just press delete. And there we go. And this saves you a lot of time because you don't have to go over every single hair with your healing brush or with your clone tool. And now the only thing I have to do is go over the hairs that I don't like and just do it with the healing brush. But this is more like a cleanup job instead of doing it all. This one I already thought that would be a little bit of a problem. But hey, it looks very, very convincing, so don't do it too much. Okay, cool. And on top, looks nice. There we go. Okay. Now, one of the things that I always love to do with my images is give it a tint. Now, there's one piece of software that I can highly, highly, highly recommend to you guys, and that's Alien Skin Exposure. Now, I think Alien Skin Exposure is without a doubt my favorite plugin for this kind of stuff. And the reason I'm always tinting my images is I love analog photography. And with analog photography, you always get that nice look. And I sometimes miss that with digital. It's perfect because we use a light meter, we use color checkers. Everything looks perfect, but I don't want perfect. I want, well, a little bit different tint, a little bit different color. Look at the difference, for example. It just enhances the reds a little bit. And what I will do is I will just go over these settings until I find something that I really like. I sometimes jokingly call this the clickety-click until you see what you like stuff. Oh, love this. This is really nice. before and after. Yep, gives just a little bit more opening and a little bit more blue. And look at the reds. They get this really nice quality here. Yep, love it. Okay, just press apply.
Can I ask a question
yeah,
too,
you can
Frank?
Ask a question.
Is this kind of Rembrandt lighting? Because the triangle under her eyes?
You might call this Rembrandt lighting, yes, without a doubt, because you have that Rembrandt triangle. That's one of the things that Rembrandt lighting actually is different from other lighting sources, is Rembrandt lighting, because you're lighting straight over the nose, is you get this beautiful triangle of light here. And that's actually because you're using the nose shadow. A lot of people try Rembrandt lighting and they actually fail miserably. And they go like, why the heck doesn't it work? Follow the shadows. This is the best advice I can give you. I can skip the whole digital classroom. I can skip all my workshops, all my tutorials. The first thing you have to learn is follow the shadows. Never follow the light. Because if you follow the light, you're actually following the shadows. The thing is, when you follow the shadows, you can literally see where the light is coming from. Because if you see that there's a little bit of triangle here, and you follow the shadow areas, you can actually see that the shadows fall that way. So you know that your lighting is actually behind or slightly behind your model instead of in front. And this is what I see sometimes a lot of guys doing, is they start doing Rembrandt lighting and they try to do it straight on. That's butterfly. And then they move it a little bit more to the side, a little bit more to the side, and at one point they just give up because they don't get that triangle. Go a little bit further. Actually, when you do Rembrandt lighting, the lighting like you saw here, I'm actually here, the model is here, and the lighting is actually almost on the other side, just barely going over that nose, giving the triangle. That's also why with Rembrandt lighting, you just play with shadows, and that's why I love it. By the way, another really good painter you should check out is Caravaggio. Maybe even better than Rembrandt. Dare I say that as a Dutchman. Okay, let me see. On the top, on the top part, it looks okay. So I'm gonna go here. And I'm going to go for curves, and by just checking it, yep, looks pretty good. Oh, this is Caravaggio.
This is how you
I can only show it very shortly because of copyright issues or whatever. But this is Caravaggio. This is how you spell it. And trust me, this is amazing. And now you can actually see where my love for reds comes from. Almost every single thing, every single painting, it's like he just finished the painting. And then at one point he said, okay, the painting is done. Give me my red paint. And he just makes one red swirl somewhere. And you go like, wow, that's it. So Caravaggio, awesome. By the way, a lot of people nowadays, when you look at YouTube, and this goes for a lot of things, start learning your classics. Start learning painters. You don't have to paint, but start looking at painters. Because you can't learn photography well if you don't look at painters. For the very simple reason, painters are actually doing what we do with light. They're actually less limited for the very simple reason. They can put light where we can't. So when you can recreate a painting with lighting, you're actually a very good photographer. You're very, very good. You're a master at lighting. Because a painter, let me put it this way. If we put the light a little bit too low, the eyes will get dark and you get a very, very nice shallow Rembrandt triangle. If you're a painter, you just open up the eyes and have a very, very shallow Rembrandt lighting. If we want to do it as photographers, what we have to do is lower that light to get more light in the eye, and it will actually destroy a little bit of that beautiful Rembrandt lighting. So by looking at a painting and just trying to recreate it, the first thing you will notice is it's incredibly hard, because painters can literally just take a little bit of a walk with nature, physics, or you know what I mean, right, with how lighting works. We as photographers, we have to solve that. And of course, we can use a little bit of Photoshop. Hey, they cheat, we cheat, right? Okay, so love this shot. Save it, layer, flatten image. And file, close. Okay, now one thing, and I want to stress this. When you see me using this kind of stuff, you see me using presets. And on presets, and I do this every other digital classroom, don't spend 200 euros on presets for the very simple reason it's not worth it. All the presets you can make yourself, and you should use them as a base. I also use them as a base and then I change them. If you want some really cool presets, and a lot of those presets go here. Go to frankdorff.com/presets. The cool thing about my presets is very simple. They're only 10 euros. And that's a lot less than other guys ask. And they're exactly the same, even probably more I give you than others. And these are your base, and for 10 euros you can't go wrong, so just get them there and don't pay 200 or whatever. And I'm very sorry if you sell your presets for 200 euros, don't flame me, it's just my opinion. Presets are very simple to make. That's not true, by the way. Sometimes I spend weeks and months on creating a preset pack, but in essence you can do the same, so that's why we sell them actually way too cheap. Let's raise the price on a week to 300. I'm just thinking about it. We should raise
the price. Great idea. So we can visit the museum. There's one question on Facebook from Franz. He says, Central Museum Utrecht has a lot of paintings of Caravaggio or in Caravaggio style. Yeah. So that might be nice to visit if we raise the prices.
Yeah, if we raise the prices, we can actually go to a museum because now I also have to work every time. Okay, are the presets for Patreons free? Oh, come on, Hans. Only 10 euros. Come on. Okay, let me do it this way. You were right. Let me do something. Let me do something for you guys. And I'm not going to do this easily. Okay. I'm only going to do this once. And I'm not going to do it again. So this is a one-time deal. Our Patreons, our guys that pay us $1 a month or $10 a month or $25 a month. You're free to pay whatever you want. $1, it starts. Our Patreons will get behind-the-scenes images. I already shot some images today. They will get behind-the-scenes live streams. Just before Digital Classroom, I did a 3 or 4 minute live stream where I showed everything, how it works here, what kind of software you use. I explained Wirecast a little bit. And we also do that during photo shoots. We show you the light setups, we show you everything that goes on. And when we go out, we actually also film some stuff that normally is in the vlog, but isn't in the vlog. So it's only for Patreons. And if you are in a tier that I believe is $15 or more per month, every month you can get me one image or two. I'm not that picky, one or two images. And I will do a whole video. It's like a video of 5 to 15 minutes. Some are even 20 minutes. And I will show you what I would do differently lighting-wise. And I will do a whole retouch for you. And even the guys and girls that are in our Patreon for over a year, they still send me images and they go like, ah, I didn't see that one. So it's a really cool way of learning. Now, why did I start this? Thanks to Patreons, we can do our work because every cent we get in via Patreon, we actually invest in Digital Classroom or, quite frankly, or the vlog or whatever. And of course, BenQ, Rogue and X-Rite help us out. Awesome companies. And they help us out because otherwise Digital Classroom wouldn't exist because this is a pretty expensive thing to set up, time-wise and gear-wise. Okay, so you want your presets for free. I'm gonna so regret this. If you join our Patreon today, now let me, because there's also a rerun. If you join our Patreon before Sunday, you will get one preset pack by choice for free. Now, I'm taking a risk because some people will go into Patreon for $1 and then will cancel straight after they get the presets. You lousies. I'm not going to say it. But if you join our Patreon before Sunday, you will get one preset pack of your choice, totally free of charge. But you have to be on Patreon for $1, at least $1. If you want to do more, okay. And please don't quit right after you get your preset. So I think that's the best offer I can do. I will repeat it on social media afterwards. And that's...
It's going to be Sunday, March 10.
Yeah, Sunday, March 10.
And you already got a subscriber. Her name is Tanya. So I'll
I already got a subscriber by now. Oh.
I definitely want to see you there, Tanya. Thank you so much.
Okay, so that's going wrong already. Anyway, so that's my offer for you guys. Okay, so that's the first shot I did. Let me just do one other very quickly, just to show you guys what you can do with some funkier looks. Okay, let me just... Okay, the thing that I always do is to make sure that I'm not in doubt what I still have to do. Of course, you see the gear, but I also give him 2 stars now. Okay, let me just go... I don't like this one anymore because her eyes look the other way. So let's go to one of the blue ones. Let me see... Oh yeah, let me show you something that you can do with the blue one. Which one should I mess up? This one. Let's go to Control D. Okay, now sometimes you are in a situation where you go like, oh, I wish I had another strobe from the other side hitting that model, also giving that blue you. You can. Yes, you can. Okay, go fit on screen. First do the skin. Oh, by the way, guys, I would really appreciate it if you leave comments below if you like Digital Classroom. Tell other people about it. We recently hit 25,000 subscribers on YouTube. Now, that seems like a lot. I'm really happy with it. The problem is we're a Dutch channel with English content. And that means that YouTube doesn't pick us up as favorite or highly recommended or whatever. And that means that we literally have to fight for every single subscriber. You would really help us out a lot if you tell people about our channel. Subscribing is free, but you really help us out a lot. And just tell people about it. Just leave comments, because the more comments and likes we get on videos, the more YouTube is maybe getting us into that recommended videos. And because we're on an, our target group is not the target group of 13 and 14 years old, which will always press like. My target group is a little bit older, and it means that sometimes I'm the same way. I don't press that like button for the very simple reason I just don't think about it. I was not brought up that way. And that's why you see sometimes kids that have a million subscribers and a million likes, and they're 12, 13 years old and doing actually nothing on YouTube, but they are in the recommended video. So help us out with just hitting that like button, smashing it if you want, and just subscribing it and tell other people. Okay, Hans said, I will be a Patreon for $15, but Bill be next week in hospital now. Hans, we wish you all the best and we love you. And get well soon, because we miss you over here. We still have to do that plantenbak shot. Yeah, that's an inside joke, guys. Don't even think about it. One day I will explain. Not. Well, okay. There's one location in our studio that Hans doesn't like. And I said to him, one day I will make a killer shot there that you will like. And I think last week I actually did, because he didn't complain about the plantenbak. So, yeah, I think I nailed it finally. Okay, let's go to layer, flatten image. I'm going to do this really fast. I'm not going to spend a lot of time here, but I just want to take some stuff out, and I'm going to show you that cool colors. Okay, good enough. Okay, so we have one side that's blue, and I really like it, but the other side is a little bit bland. Let's say I want a little bit more blue in there too. Okay, now the first thing I have to do, and this is very important, first do your tinting. So we're going to treat the image like it's a normal image. So we're going to go to Alien Skin Exposure. It's a final image. Go to Alien Skin Exposure. Find the look that I like. I actually like this look, so why not? Do apply. Okay. But now I also want some more blue on this side. And you can do it with any color. So you can also blend colors together. This is a really cool trick. Okay, come on. Okay, there we go. Okay, layer, flatten image. Now I have to take that one out, because with Alien Skin Exposure, it does give a little bit more contrast. So let's just blend this away. Will it blend? Yes, it will. Cool. Okay, do a new layer. On top, of course. Okay. Just zoom down just one step. There we go. Okay, take a brush with paint. Make it really big, and select the blue that you like, for example this, and just do this. Now make sure that you don't hit the face. There we go. Now the only thing you have to do is actually do this. Just go into soft light, or hard light, or go to vivid light, or go to difference. Nah, that doesn't look right. Go to color, lumosity. You can change whatever you want and go for the look that you like, but in most cases for me, it will be like overlay or soft light. Overlay, soft light, maybe hard light, but soft light is better. And as you can see now, it just gives you that same hue on the other side. Now, if you're not that happy with it, don't worry, because it's a different layer. The cool thing what you can now do is actually go here, and you can change the intensity by using curves. Cool. You can also change the color. Oh, sorry. You can also change the color by using hue. And of course, saturation. And maybe lightness, or darker. Okay, now it might seem, if you look at this shot, that I didn't do anything until I turn it off. And now you can see that we have that blue tone also on the other side. Now, of course, you can do... Let me try something more. New layer. Let's say that we also use a red strobe. This is going to look absolutely ridiculous, but Hey, just for fun. Let me do a really red. Like a 10-stop disaster red. Okay, let me say this is it. Okay, let's blur this a little bit. Okay. And do the same thing. Go to soft light. And now you can see that we're actually blending those colors together. So zero, just do it a little bit. There we go. Now it looks like we also got some light from the bottom. Now again, I don't like this, so I'm going to take this one out. But you can literally just do portraits or whatever with just blending those colors together. If you forgot to put, for example, a gel on your strobe. Will it be 100% natural? No, not really. But at least it's better than nothing, right? Maybe just blend it a little bit less. There we go. Okay, layer, flatten image. And file, close. And yes. Okay, cool. Any more questions, Annemiek? Oh, we have a lot. Let me just do this.
Those are not questions. Those are announcements.
Announcements.
Oh no my. Questions on Facebook, but maybe on YouTube.
Somebody says, may I suggest F11 for that plantenbak shot? Yeah, okay, now I have to explain. Okay, so we have this group, and this group is called A Year with Frank. If you try to push me, I will push you. This group is called A Year with Frank. Now, in this group, we had some really cool guys like Hans and Cindy and Ari, and now we have Wim and John. Do I forget somebody? No, right? And they actually did it in 2 years. And that means that you get a really nice connection with those people, because those people visit almost every workshop. They get a lot of personal attention, and it's just a really cool program. And the thing is that in between shots, Hans actually said to me, Frank, you're shooting a lot on F11. At one point I said, well, not really. And then I started looking, and during workshops, I indeed shoot a lot on F8 and F11, while in my free work, I shoot a lot on 2.8, 4, 5.6 or F22, depending on what I need. For jumping shots, I use F16 or F22. Then I started thinking about it. The reason I'm shooting a lot on F11, F8 during workshops is because students, attendees of the workshops, I want to make sure that they get proper exposed images, of course, but also proper sharp images. Now, when you're a little bit nervous, you're working for the first time with a model, it can be that you miss a little bit of focus on, for example, the eye in the back instead of the front eye. So that's why we actually, during workshops, shoot on F11 or F8. It doesn't mean that you have to shoot on it. So it became a standard joke a little bit, like, hey, we have to shoot on F11. And at one point it became, if Hans wasn't there, I said, oh, now I can shoot on F11 because Hans isn't there. And the same thing with the plantenbak. So now you know, this is all the inside jokes, don't worry. Okay, 16 and 17 March, or March 16 and 17. I will be in the UK for the photography show. Awesome, I will be on one of the main stages, Annemiek.
Yes.
It's a half-hour show, and what we're going to do is we're going to show you a quick introduction to my work, and after that we're going to do a live shoot, all in half an hour, so I have to talk really fast. I want to show you some really interesting shots which you can do with excellent lighting, lens flares, but also some tricks that I didn't show a lot before, like putting strobes straight into the lens. It's going to be really, really interesting. So if you're in the UK, make sure you check it out on March 16th and 17th.
Well, actually, the show is a little bit longer.
The show is a little bit longer, but we're there for 2 days.
Yeah.
Then on March 23, 24, 25, we have Professional Imaging in the Netherlands. It's the biggest trade show in the Netherlands. It's the best trade show in the Netherlands. It's the most coolest trade show in the Netherlands. I don't know what to say more. You just have to go there. If you don't have tickets yet, make sure you check it out at professionalimaging.nl. It's absolutely stunning show. A lot of good speakers. We have Chris Knight, Clint Dewis, Dave Clayton, myself, John Hernandez, I believe, Brendan de Klerk, Brett Florence, the list goes on. Pim Ras, I believe, this time also, yeah. Great sports photographer. Awesome show, you have to go there. Then April 6th, and we only have 3 seats left, so be quick. In cooperation with BenQ, we're doing Landskrona in Sweden. That's April 6th. Then on for the Netherlands, on June 22, we have a railway station that we're going to do a workshop. We're going to promote that very soon, so if you want, please join me in email. On June 29th, we're in Delft. And for you Americans, September 1st, New York. And what a coincidence. The studio is called Studio FD. And we booked the dark room. That sounds weird. It is weird. It's awesome. It's a room where there's a lot of weird lighting. We're going to mix light sources. I kid you not, that dark room over there, that's exactly the studio that I wish I had, because they have a lot of cool stuff and it's just a stunning, stunning studio. We already have the website on for New York, so make sure you check that out.
No, I'm working on that.
Oh, you're working on
that. I'm working on that, yeah.
We should have the workshops on this weekend. This weekend you can register for that workshop. So that's September 1st, straight after Photoshop World. And, well, Photoshop World Las Vegas, that is. I think that's it. Do we have something on the back? Oh, yeah, and of course, Patreons. Please join Patreon and hit that like button. Any more questions? Let me see. Thank you. I love this one. May I suggest? Okay. Any okay, the rest I did, I think. Do we have anything on Facebook?
No.
Okay. Thank you so very much for watching, guys. And if you like what we do, you know what to do. See you again next time. Bye-bye. And of course, thank you, BenQ and Rogue, for making this possible. You guys rock.